In this section, we will discuss about OSPF database description packets. And these are the type 2 OSPF packets. In our previous section, we have discussed about OSPF type 1 packet, that was the hello packet, right? So the content of the OSPF DBD packets are the MTU. So the information of the maximum transmission unit or MTU will be traveled along with the database description packets. So as of now, do not worry about the sequence, like when the DRBDR election happens or at what stage the DBD packets are exchanged. So we'll discuss about the OSPF states in detail. But before we go into those details, I would like to, you know, discuss about the base of that particular process, the what is the hello message and what are all the different type of messages or packets that will be a part of that particular process to form the OSPF neighborship and different states. Okay, so the content of the DBD packets are the MTU, and the second one is the options. So the option field is same as we discussed in our previous section, or in the type 1 OSPF packet, that was hello, it's the same field. Also, we have some important bits in the DBD packets that are I bit. I means the init bit. Also, we do have the M bit. M means more bit. And then we also have an MS bit, or which is also known as the master bit. Okay. Also, the DBD packet will be having the DBD sequence number, that will be a randomly generated sequence number. And this sequence number plays an important role into the OSPF database description exchange messages. Also, it will contain the LSA headers. So into the DBD packets, the LSA headers, or there will be a small information that will be exchanged. The whole network information will not be sent or will not be communicated between the devices. Only a small information, or we can say that LSA headers for those particular information will be exchanged between the devices. And that information will be enough for the devices to find out what information they need to request from the neighbor, okay? The master slave election will be taken place. So the one which is having the higher router ID will becomes the master. Okay. Also, in our previous slide, we have discussed about I and M bit. So I and M bit works in the pair. So let's say the I bit is 1 and M bit is 0. It means that we have small information, and all the LSA headers can be described using a single DBD packet. If both the values I and M are having a value of 1, it means that multiple DBD packets are required. That means that we do have a lot of information which cannot be described using a single DBD packet, and it needs multiple DBD packets, okay, to send that particular information. If both I and M are 0, it means that this is the last DBD packet, okay? If I is 0 and M is 1, it means that this particular packet is somewhere between the first and the last DBD packet that will be exchanged between the devices. The key point in this particular exchange is that only the master device or the master node can increment the sequence number, okay? So the slave is not going to take any action as a part of increment of the sequence number. So in OSPF, the acknowledgement of the DBD packets will be done by using the, if you talk about the slave. So if slave needs to acknowledge any DBD packet that was sent by the slave, let's say slave sent, the master sent a DBD packet with a sequence number of 100 to the slave. So now slave needs to give the acknowledgement of that particular DBD packet. So slave will not increment that particular sequence number, that it received from the master that was 100. So it will send the acknowledgement with the same sequence number, and the master will get to know that, okay, the slave received that particular information. Only master can increment the sequence number. So it means that master is going to increment its own sequence number, right? So this is the theoretical portion about the DBD or the database description packet. Now let's jump into the practical and quickly see what are the details and all. And also let's do some capture. We will use this simple topology. We have R1 and R2. Both these devices are connected via the broadcast media or with the fast Ethernet 0x0. I am on R1. So if I do a show IP interface brief, so we do have a fast Ethernet 0x0, wherein we do have the IP 10.1.1.1, and on loopback 0, we have 20.1.1.1. So to check on which interface OSPF is enabled, we can run the command show IP OSPF interface brief. So right now I'm running OSPF on loopback 0 and fast Ethernet 0x0. Let's go to R2. If I do show IP interface brief. So on R2, we are running, we are also running OSPF, and we do have the IP address on fast Ethernet 0x0, which is having IP 10.1.1.2. Show IP OSPF interface brief. Also, let's configure the router ID manually. If I do a router OSPF 1, router ID 0.0.0.2. Okay. And let's clear the process, clear IP OSPF process. Yes. Show IP protocols. Now we can check the router ID. Now it is changed, right? Let's do the same on R1 also. Show IP protocols. Here also we do have the router ID, which is picked up by the OSPF process by itself because we did not configure it manually. So I'll go to the router OSPF 1 and I'll say router ID 0.0.0.1, clear IP OSPF process. By default it is no, so we need to say yes. Show IP protocols. Now the router ID is changed. Okay. Now if I do a show IP OSPF neighbors, so neighborship is up, right? Now let's capture it. Start capture. Let's wait for the Wireshark pop-up. Start Wireshark. Okay, now because the neighborship is already up, so now the database description exchange cannot be seen into the Wireshark, right? Because it happened once there was the neighborship criteria and all those messages were exchanged in the start, right? So to initiate the DBD exchange or communication again, what we can do is we can clear the process. If I do a clear IP OSPF process again, then both these devices are going to exchange the DBD process again or the DBD packets again, okay? Now let's go to Wireshark. Now we can see again the database description packets are exchanged, right? Now let's analyze them. So this is the first DBD packet, which is sent by R1, right? So it's the number packet number 43. So let's open it. So we are very much familiar about the OSPF header, and we already discussed about this in our previous section also. OSPF header will contain the OSPF router ID and the area ID, right? Now let's open the DVD packet. So this is the first information that we discussed, the very critical information. That is the MTU, and MTU must match on both the sides, okay? So the interface MTU is 1500. Also, we do have the option field. This I already told you, right? Because this is the same information that was there in the hello packet. The options are same. Now let's open the database and description. So in the database description packet, we have the init bit, more bit, and the master bit. So init bit is sent to one, and master bit is also, more bit is also sent to one. So it means that it has more information, or it will send the multiple DVD informations, right? Also, because see, right now the master election is not happened, right? So both the devices R1 and R2 are going to announce themselves as a master. So now this packet is from R1, right? The source is 10.1.1.1 and destination is 10.1.1.2. So R1 is saying that I am the master. So master bit is yes. A random sequence number is generated by R1, which is 6195. Okay. Now, let's see the next DVD packet, which is from R2 to R1. Packet number 45. So in packet number 45, we have the OSPF header, wherein we do have the router ID of R2, area ID also. In the DVD, we do have the interface MTU, which configured, which is 1500 byte, right, by default. Also in the DVD packet, we do have the master bit. And master bit is set to yes. It means that R2 is also announcing itself as a master switch, or as a master, right? Also, it generated a random sequence number 3028. The sequence number that was generated by R1 was 6195. All right. Now, let's see the next DVD packet. So now we were at packet number 45. Let's open the DVD packet from R1. So this is the packet from R1. So now we can see that, because see, R1 is having the router ID 0.0.0.1 and R2 is having the router ID 0.0.0.2. So the router ID, as we discussed in our slide, that the higher router ID will win, right? Or the device which is having the higher router ID will become the master. So now this is the packet from R1. We can see that source is 10.1.1. So this is the DVD packet from R1. So R1 sends to R2. And now see this time. Also the I bit and M bit are zero. So in our slide, we discussed that when the I bit and M bit are zero, it means that this is the last packet, right? Also now, because R1 knows that it has the lower router ID, so it means that the R2 is the master. So now it is saying that I am not the master. And also see this one. The sequence number 3028. 3028 was the sequence number that was generated by R2. So now R1 is mimicking, or it is sending the same sequence number that was generated by R2 as an acknowledgement. Okay. Now, this is frame number 46. Now close it. Now let's say the reply from R2. Now see what R2 is saying. R2 is saying, yes, I am the master. And look here, 3029, what we discussed. Only master can increment the sequence number, right? The sequence number that was sent in the previous DVD packet from R1, that was 3028. Now master incremented that particular sequence number, right? It's 3028. 29. This is the packet from R2 that will be sent to R1, because R2 is the master, so it only can increment the DVD packet sequence number, and it is the master, right? Also, the I and M bits are 0, correct? It means that this is the last sequence number from my side, okay? Now, also what we discussed, that the LSA's header will be a part of the DVD packet, because now the master and slave elections is done. Now they know who is the master, who is the slave. Now the it will also contain the LSA headers. Okay, so the LSA informations will also be there now. Now let's see it with a practical also. So we have already seen the content of the DVD packets into the Wiresharp. Now let's talk about the MTU, because as we know that the MTU must match between both of the neighbor, right? Otherwise, the neighborship is not going to come up. So if I do a show interface FA0/0, the MTU is 1500. But when we run this command, show interface and then the interface number, the MTU that we are looking at right now, this is the layer 2 MTU. This is not the layer 3 MTU, okay? So in OSPF, the MTU that we are discussing, that is the layer 3 MTU. Okay, if you want to see the information of layer 3 MTU, we need to run the command show IP interface and then the interface number. Okay, so here we do have the MTU or the layer 3 MTU, which is 1500 byte. The multicast groups are 224.0.0.5, which is for all OSPF routers, and this one for the DR and BDR, right? So now let's try to change the MTU. I am on interface FA0/0. Let's say IP MTU 1400. So now the MTU is mismatched between R1 and R2. If I do a show IP OSPF neighbor. So the neighborship is still up, right? So why the neighborship is not going down, though the MTU is changed between the link, right? If I do a show IP interface FA0/0 on R1, here the MTU is 1400. But if we check on the link at R2, show interface FA0/0, sorry, show IP interface. Interface FA0/0. Here the MTU is 1500, but our neighborship is not going down, it's still up. Show IP OSPF neighbor. It is not going down, right? Why? Because the MTU is not a part of hello message, right? See, now the neighborship is up, and both the devices, they are exchanging the hello messages, right? If we open the Wiresharp and if we open any hello message, let me open any hello message again. So if you open the hello message does not contain any information about the MTU. See, this is the hello message, and we have the network mask, we have the hello interval, the option field. In the option field also, we don't have any MTU. We have the router priority, the dead interval, the DR information, BDR information, and the neighbor information, but we don't have any information related to the MTU. That is why the neighborship is not going down, because R1 and R2, they cannot find out if there is a mismatch in the MTU, because the MTU information is a part of DVD packet, right? And once the neighborship is up, the DVD packets will not be exchanged. So now we know a trick when to to generate the DVD packets again, right? Once we clear the process, the DVD packets will be exchanged, and then the devices can, or the OSPF process will eventually find out that there is a problem in the MTU. So let's also enable one debug. If I do a debug IP OSPF adjacencies, now let's clear the process. Clear IP OSPF process. I would say yes. Okay, undebug all. If I do a show IP OSPF neighbor, now we can see that our neighborship stuck in the xstart state. So as I mentioned earlier also, do not worry about these states. We will discuss all the states, down attempt, init, xstart, exchange, what are the different content of these states and what exactly happened in each state. But now we see that because MTU is a part of DVD communication. So now, because once we clear the process, the DVD communication will start again. And because MTU is a part of DVD packets, now the devices finds out that the MTU is mismatched. Now here you can see the message that fast Ethernet 0x0 neighbor 0.0.0.2 or R2 has larger interface MTU, right? Because on R2 side, the MTU is still 1500 and on R1 it is 1400. So clearly it is mentioning that the R2 or the neighbor 0.0.0.2 is having larger interface MTU. Okay, so this was all about the database description packets. In our next section, we will discuss about the type 3 OSPF packet, that is the LSR or the link state request packet. Before we close this session or this lecture, what we can also do is we can run one command to ignore this MTU criteria. If I do a router OSPF 1 IP OSPF, or I think it's on the under the interface. Let me check. I don't remember exactly. It's IP OSPF ignore MTU something. Let me check. IP OSPF MTU ignore. So now once we run this command, this criteria is not going to be matched and our neighborship will come up. If I do a show IP OSPF, show IP interface FA0x0, you can see still we do have the 1400 MTU, right? But now we'll see that our neighborship will eventually come up. Show IP OSPF neighbor. Let's clear it. Or now you can see that it's already up. Show IP OSPF neighbor. So this is the command to bypass this particular condition. Okay. If I do a show run section router OSPF or show run interface FA0x0. So this is the command that we can run, IP OSPF MTU ignore. But see, this is a workaround, but the best solution is to keep the MTU same on both sides. But if we know that there won't be any problem, or we do have some kind of use case that anyhow we need to make the neighborship up, right? Even if the other end MTU is different, then we can run this command IP OSPF MTU ignore under the interface. Then in that condition, our MTU mismatch condition will be bypassed. So this was all about OSPF type 2 packet or the database description packet. In our next section, we will discuss about the type 3 or the link state request packet.